Welcome back to Chemistry Matters and the sixth video on our Unit 4 playlist, Chemical Bonding. How did your melting temperature lab with salt and sugar turn out? Let's get right out to our classroom so you can see how your results compare to the results of our students.
Emily and Ron, tell me how the melting point lab went with the sugar.
It didn't take very long at all for the sugar to start to melt.
Yeah, it starts to melt at 45 seconds.
Okay. Wyatt and Dahlia, what were the results with your attempt to melt the salt?
We couldn't get the salt to melt at all.
Yeah, after a minute, it still looked exactly the same.
How long would it have taken for the salt to melt?
It's not so much the length of time, but the temperature you'd have to reach. You'd need to raise the temperature of the sodium chloride over its melting point, which is 801 degrees Celsius. A Bunsen burner flame can certainly get that hot if you're working with a nice flame with an inner cone. But that's why we did our experiment with hot plates, so you could easily see the difference in the melting points of the two substances.
Wow, then there's definitely something different about the way salt is put together compared to sugar.
Yeah, what's the difference in these two?
Can one of you answer that?
They obviously have different melting points.
Does a higher melting point for a substance mean it's held together more tightly?
It does. What else does your evidence tell you?
Well, we know salt is sodium chloride, and that's an ionic bond. So the high melting point must be because it has an ionic bond.
And we learned ionic bonds are the strongest of the intramolecular chemical bonds.
Good job. Look at this image that illustrates what has to happen in order for an ionic compound to melt. All of those cations and anions are tightly packed in a crystal lattice. To get the salt to melt, we have to put enough energy into the crystal to overcome all of those electrostatic attractions between the ions. These are very strong intramolecular forces, and it takes a lot of energy to overcome them. Compounds that have covalent bonds, like sucrose, which is table sugar, usually have lower melting and boiling points. That's because most substances that contain covalent bonding tend to form molecules. Molecules are groups of atoms that have chemically bonded and behave as individual units. These molecules have characteristic shapes like you see here. When melting a molecular compound, you just need to put enough energy into the substance so that the molecules that are held together by intermolecular forces begin to gain more kinetic energy and start to move past each other. To melt sugar, you only need to break intermolecular forces, not any intramolecular bonds. This means it typically requires a lot less energy to melt covalent compounds compared to ionic compounds.
So what about ionic compounds? They don't have shapes?
Actually, most ionic compounds would look like the crystal lattice structures I just showed you. This is because of the tight packing of the cations and anions, due to the high strength of the attraction of their bonds. The attractive forces acting between molecules are known as intermolecular forces. They're all weaker than intramolecular forces like covalent bonds. Intermolecular forces are also much weaker than the attraction between ions in ionic compounds. That's why compounds that are made up of covalently bound molecules tend to have much lower melting points than compounds that are more ionic in character.
Well, what exactly is happening when the sugar is melting?
Yeah, are we breaking these covalent bonds? Are their shapes changing as they melt?
Those are great questions. And no, those covalent bonds are not being broken when covalently bonded compounds melt. And their shapes don't change either. Those weaker intermolecular forces are overcome when we heat these solids. So eventually the molecules start to slide past each other as the compound starts to melt. As an example, the water molecule is a V-shaped molecule, whether it's a gas, a liquid, or a solid, as an ice.
Well, what about an ionic compound then? What happens to, say, salt, if I were able to melt it?
If we were to add this much energy to sodium chloride, it would eventually melt, and we would have molten or liquid sodium chloride. Chemists can take molten sodium chloride and run what is known as electrolysis to isolate elemental sodium or chlorine gas. These are very reactive elements that are not normally found in nature in their elemental form.
Now that you have a solid understanding, not only of how chemical bonds work, but of the different types of chemical bonds as well, this is a good time to see how all of the concepts we've explored in this unit apply to the real world. And to do that, I spoke with Dr. Pete Ludovis, a professor of chemical engineering at Georgia Tech's School of Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering. What is a chemical engineer?
So a chemical engineer, like all engineers, takes a little bit of science and a little bit of math and applies some creative problem solving to figure out a solution to a societal problem. And that creative problem solving is something we call engineering, and the solution we often call technology. So we have science, math, engineering, and technology. The whole thing spells SMET. At least that's what the National Science Foundation wanted to call it in the early 90s. Cooler heads prevailed. We rearranged it, rebranded it. We now call that STEM.
Much better word.
And the thing about chemical engineers is we use the principles of chemistry to do that engineering or creative problem solving. The main difference between the chemist and the chemical engineer is that the chemist worries about the phenomenon, whereas the chemical engineer uses those phenomenon to create these solutions to societal problems. Very often, the difference we observe is that the chemist works at the bench scale, and if they produce a material or a catalyst or a pharmaceutical that's very, very important, we need to produce it at the 100-pound or 100,000-ton level. We do it on a much bigger scale.
Gotcha. Now, talk to us specifically about what you do at Georgia Tech in your lab.
So what I do at Georgia Tech is I am a modeler. Right? I'm actually a molecular modeler. So I do something that the chemist would describe as computational chemistry. And I do that because computers have gotten very, very fast. And we are now able to model some of the chemical reactions, the chemical phenomenon, the chemical properties of materials in a computer. And I do that because back in 1966, Dr. Mulliken, who got the first Nobel Prize for computational chemistry, said, one day we'll go to the computer instead of the lab. And let's face it, the computer is cheaper, it's easier, it's faster, it's safer. You don't have to wear safety glasses when you're working at your terminal. And we might get some of our solutions from that method.
Now, you work a lot with bonds.
Yes.
Why does a chemical engineer need to know about bonds?
Well, because we take the principles of chemistry and try to apply creative problem solving, what we do is we change bonds, we manipulate bonds, and then we also take advantage of the bonds in a particular molecule to use that with different processing and different packing of the molecules to create materials that are one of the solutions to these particular problems. So bonds are very important to a chemical engineer.
Now let's talk about some of these materials and their properties and how that relates to bonds. We'll look at opposites.
Okay.
So some materials are great electric conductors. And some are insulators. What's the difference there?
So it has to do with the bonding mode. Previously, you very likely talked about covalent bonds and ionic bonds. So metals have this bonding mode. And when we say bond, we think bond is some physical thing that we can hold and touch and see. Linus Pauling, who wrote a lot about the nature of the chemical bond, always pointed out it's not really there. It's sort of a fluid thing. It is a stable arrangement of electrons, but different bonding types have different sorts of properties. And in a metal, the electrons can flip back and forth between each other. They can move a lot. They're very, very fluid. And that's what electrical conduction is. So in organic polymers, where I work, they aren't as fluid. They usually have covalent bonds and not ionic bonds. But you can even manipulate organic polymers to do that. For example, if you take a double bond, which has a little electron density in it, and you make a polymer like polyacetylene, which has every other bond one of those double bonds, the electrons are mobile enough to hop in between those things, and you can actually make a conductive polymer. So we do make a lot of conductive polymer that take advantage of this alternating double bond. It's called conjugated double bond. Then if we put a lot of these double bonds together in a plane, that's actually graphene, and graphene is very conductive. We now believe that graphene may be the basis for some of our future microelectronics technology because it can conduct. It's organic, and it also has some other useful properties because it's organic, right? So metals tend to oxidize. They're not as flexible. So you can actually make organic polymers conductive by changing the way you do the bonds.
Very cool. So our next pair of opposites, some materials are very strong. We might use them to build large structures. Some materials are very flexible. We might use them to make cloth. What's the difference between those?
So the difference between those is again, it's the bonding mode. So the most strong material, but also some of the most brittle materials are ceramics. Mm-hmm. And ceramics are metal oxides. So your window pane glass, your toilet, those are ceramics. And they're very, very strong. They're also very, very resistant to chemical oxidation and things like that. So they're very useful for that sort of thing. But they're very brittle, right? You hit them with a hammer and they crack. So the best materials aren't necessarily just strong or just flexible. There's something called tough. That they are both flexible and strong, and they can absorb a lot of energy, but they can also deform to absorb a lot more energy. That's the sort of thing we want. So we might mix a ceramic material with a flexible material, and polymers are very flexible materials, right? They are basically what make up most plastics. And polymers get their physical integrity not by having bonds between every single atom, like a ceramic, but bonds along a chain, then the chains orient, and the oriented chains have a weaker interaction between them, so it makes a flexible film or a flexible fiber. And the best kind of material mixes flexible materials like polymers and very strong but brittle materials like ceramics. And the best example would be the modern tennis racket. Do you play tennis?
I am not nearly that coordinated.
Okay. Well, I'm not that coordinated either, but the good news is the modern tennis racket is very light and very strong, so you don't have to be all that good at tennis. In the old days, we made them out of wood. Wood, believe it or not, is Mother Nature's ceramic. It's a very complicated material that's both strong and flexible, but it tends to warp and it bends when you get it wet and things like that. So it's not a perfect material. Then we made them out of metal. Metal is too heavy. So now we make a ceramic polymer composite. And if you go in a sporting goods store and pick up a tennis racket, it is very, very strong, slightly flexible, but also very, very light. So that's another reason to do composites. So,
and it improves your game.
It improves people that know how to play tennis. It improves my game only marginally.
Gotcha. Now, perhaps the most critical pair of opposites, some materials are edible and some materials are explosive.
Now, I would have gone with edible and inedible. So, yes, I would agree. Those are definitely opposites. Opposites in the extreme. Explosive materials are very simple. They are simply molecules that when they oxidize, when they burn so rapidly that the flame front moves faster than the speed of sound. So rather than having something go whoosh, it actually compresses the air. That shockwave is the explosion. Hmm. And any material that will do that works perfectly fine. So we've learned over the years that nitrate groups are very good for making molecules like that. So if you think of typical explosives like nitroglycerin, that's glycerin with a nitrate group attached to it. Trinitrotoluene, that's TNT, that's toluene with three nitro groups on it. Those groups tend to be very explosive. Mm-hmm. And in fact, if you're looking for explosives, one of the things you can do is test for nitrate groups. Whenever they find nitrate groups, that's usually used in explosives. So edible molecules or edible polymers, for example, and we have plenty of them, they usually have some sort of a polar group on them. So instead of just pure carbon, they will have nitrogens, they will have oxygens on them. So the enzymes inside your body can actually grab onto them, transform them, and metabolize them. A good example would be if you were to take benzene, which is a great organic solvent. It's a six-membered aromatic ring. It is highly toxic, but it's also highly carcinogenic. And a lot of the ways we cause cancer in the human body is when we cannot metabolize something. It literally sits in there and irritates tissue until cancer eventually occurs. You can't do anything with benzene, but if you put one carbon on it, one methyl group, that's enough that your body can oxidize the methyl group. That would be toluene. And it can oxidize that into benzoic acid. And benzoic acid we can process. In fact, benzoic acid is often used as a preservative in food. Sure. So something polar that you can grab onto usually has to be water soluble. That helps. Mm-hmm. Good example of that would be a polymer that a lot of people use, polyethylene glycol, sometimes called polyethylene oxide. It is water soluble. It actually has amazing properties. It tends to coil up and entangle, and it makes fluids very thick. So if you see polyethylene glycol, it's written PEG, usually PEG 40, meaning there's 40 units, or PEG 80. You often find it in consumer products, and you can even find it in food. So that is actually edible.
In all this talk of opposites, it seems like some of the most interesting technology falls in the middle, and we can make small changes to these molecules to bridge those two opposites and find materials that are better, stronger, more useful.
Right, right. So you mix the strong but brittle with the flexible but weak to make something that's actually tough. The same is true when you talked about conductors and insulators. Sure. So what's really interesting is you can take an insulator like silicon and dope it with just the right metals. By doping, I mean add tiny little bits of these things, mm-hmm. and you can actually make that a semiconductor. So that's in between a conductor and an insulator. It will conduct, but only if you give it just enough electrical potential mm-hmm. to promote it to the conduction band. And by looking at that band gap, we can actually design a transistor out of semiconductors. So the entire semiconductor field is based on one of these midpoints between conductors and insulators, and that's the semiconductor.
You mentioned chemical engineering being a creative field, and that's mm-hmm. evidence of it right there.
Absolutely. And in fact, I do a lot of statistical mechanical simulations. One of our biggest problems is we work on the photoresist polymers that we coat to etch the patterns into the next microelectronics chips. And what we're trying to do is making smaller and smaller and smaller patterns. Mm-hmm. So we actually use maybe another one of these intermediate things where uh-huh. we take a block copolymer. So polymer means it's a long molecule. Copolymer means it's got two different parts, and the two parts are in blocks. They don't like each other just enough so that they phase separate to make a line of one and a line of another. And we make these very, very small. So I said they were big molecules.
Right.
But big means this half of it is a few nanometers. So it's actually quite small.
Very big is still very, very small.
Right. And if we can get them to line up, we can actually etch this sort of thing to get this to form the next generation of microelectronics chips and things like that. One of our problems is that in order to get the simulation to work, they don't unmix into that in short order. So we play a lot of very creative tricks to get it to do that. Then the final thing we do is we play video games. Okay, not literally, but we take the same graphics boards that you or your friends or people you know use to play video games. Mm-hmm. It makes your avatar look really, really cool.
Right.
We take advantage of the multiple processors on there, and it can make our systems run between 200 and 1,000 times faster. So the next time a parent opens the door, yells down in the basement and says, "Stop playing those video games, they're good for nothing." Not exactly true.
There is value down
yes,
there.
Yes, we are using them to help design the next generation of microelectronics.
Well, I understand that you are also a stand-up comedian.
Yes.
So my question is chemistry funny?
Is chemistry funny? Chemists certainly are, and I certainly think chemical engineers are as well. Because we're kind of strange. I mean, my favorite joke to tell about chemical engineers is that chemical engineers are very simple people, and we live by two simple rules. Number one, if it's broken, fix it. And number two, if it's not broken, fix it.
Well, thank you for telling us all about how you fix things.
It was my pleasure.
When we started this Unit 4 playlist on chemical bonds, you probably didn't realize that there were so many types of bonds. But as the students in our classroom found, all of the bonds we've studied in this unit, whether intramolecular bonds or intermolecular forces, are caused by electrostatic forces of attraction, which can pull on nearby atoms and molecules. If you can keep that thought in mind whenever you describe what's happening when chemicals attract each other to form new substances, you'll understand the fundamentals of chemical reactions and how they occur. And that will give you the ability to understand how chemical bonds at the atomic level affect what we see in the everyday world. So now that you're well-versed in how chemical bonds form and break, it leads us nicely into Unit 5, Chemical Reactions. But before you begin that unit, don't forget that the Unit 4 toolkit includes additional information. And there's also a closer look video for Unit 4 that will enhance your understanding of Lewis dot diagrams. When you're done with all of that, I'll be ready for you at the top of the playlist for Unit 5, Chemical Reactions.